continuing with tradition.
Will you please pray with me?
O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you. O God, who is our provider, our sustainer, our creator. Amen. My love of God and the community of Christ runs very deep, because I passionately believe in our teaching of doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly. When I see people living out these teachings, it is then that I feel a glimpse of the love and hope described in our traditions. As you know, if you didn't know before today, I'm Colombian. And like many of you, I have struggled to reconcile my privileges with the ways I am oppressed woman, and as a multi-ethnic person who never fully feels like she belongs in either of the worlds she comes from. So often, I've focused on the hope in the Bible that claims liberation. And while I continue to focus on liberation and on hope, I know that we were also given a plan for how to live out our lives. As some of my friends in Bible study group that we're part of have mentioned, we've talked about one Bible study group that I don't go to often enough, but we've talked about covenant and promise, and that God has a covenant for our lives, right? God promises us liberation, but that covenant, that promise, that relationship is a two-way street. God says, I will bring you out of exile from the land of Egypt, but you need to follow a new way. The precursor to today's scripture is the Exodus manna story, which says that the people should take just enough of the food given for the day, and that hoarding would make the food rot. The first lesson after the receive their hope and are liberated from Egypt is all about surviving in the wilderness. What is your wilderness? What are your trials and tribulations? This Exodus manna story says to create a different system, to remember the promise that God has for us, to gather what we need and not more, because everyone. But we can't help but separate ourselves from the pain of our past. We instinctively hoard out of fear. Jesuit theologian John Hockey laments that we read the gospel as if we had no money, and we spend our money as if we know nothing of the gospel. So, I'd like to give you some facts. The United Nations in 1992, over 20 years ago, reported that income disparities between the world's richest and poorest had doubled since 1960. So in 32 years, they have doubled. It's only gotten worse since then. Today, the wealthiest 20% of the world's population receives about 83% of the world's income, while the poorest 20% live on less than 2%. And the poorest 40% live on less than 10%. The world's wealthiest 85 people, we have about 85 people in this building today, own as much as the poorest 3.5 billion. In 1965, the average U.S. worker made $7.52 per hour, while people running their companies made 42 times that amount per hour. Today, the average CEO makes nearly 250 times more than the average worker. This is called trickle-up economics. The transfer of wealth from the increasingly poor to the increasingly rich is what's happening. Though our brilliant economics schools teach us trickle down. I went to economics classes. We must take seriously what we learn in the Torah's Pentateuch. In Exodus 16, when the people faced trials in the wilderness, they blamed God for their famine and complained that they wished they had died enslaved in Egypt. Because at least then, they had something to eat. Like modern North Americans, the Israelites couldn't imagine life apart from the Egyptian military, industrial, technological, economic complex that enslaved them. As I said, we must take seriously what we learned from the Torah, and in the Jubilee story of reconciliation described in Leviticus, we are given hope when we are told that the wealth gaps that exist should be regularly and intentionally undone by returning to the poor and the indebted what has been taken from them. And skipping ahead a few hundred years, today's scripture is the only miracle described by all four of the Gospels. Described in Matthew chapter 14, 13 through 22, Mark chapter 6, 30 through 44, which I believe you studied last week, Luke chapter 9, verses 10 through 17, and John chapter 6, today, verses 1 through 15. As many of you know, I also am quite involved in our general denomination, and I spent some time this week with some beloved people in this community and also other beloved people that you know. And at the closing dinner of the General Assembly of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, we were able to hear from Dr. William Barber, Reverend Dr. William Barber. Reverend Dr. William Barber is the co-founder of Memorial Monday's campaign that has been taking place in the Carolinas for several years. I think this is 2003 or 6. It was very challenging and very inspiring. And he mentioned during his challenging and inspiring sermon that we can't challenge the heart of the empire because the empire lies within us. The central message of Jesus is that there is enough in the kingdom for all, which I pray is realized on earth as it is in heaven, as you all pray every Sunday. There is enough in the beloved community. So, as many of you know, I like to call myself a facilitator, a coordinator, a workshop leader, and not a preacher, although people keep asking me preachers. So, you have to get involved in today's sermon because that's what I asked. I'd like to know, what do you think human rights are? What are human rights? I'm not asking for
truth. Equality.
Equality. What do you think of when you hear the term human rights?
Things that everyone should have the right to have.
Things that everyone should have the right to have. Absolutely.
All for one and one for all.
All for one and one for all.
Justice
at the forefront.
Water.
Okay. That makes me think of, maybe Jonathan can help me with the answer I'm looking for. Every man or woman, because it's 2015, deserves the right to what?
You wander?
Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I think Mike has just described one thing we need for life. What else do we need for life?
Food.
Shelter. Air.
Clothes.
Love.
Respect for authority.
Respect
for authority.
For authority.
People.
I might challenge them.
People, absolutely.
Justice,
it depends on which one we're in.
We need one another.
We need one another, absolutely.
Peace.
Life includes water, food, shelter, healthcare, education, love,
peace, God,
and peace, God, absolutely. Brothers and sisters, much like us, our family in Colombia has a hard problem. Injustice is rampant. Colombia has been in a civil war since 1964, the longest-running civil war in recent history, and millions have been devastated by this tragedy. Colombia has more internally displaced refugees than any other country in the world next to Sudan. As Dr. Barber said this week, consciousness is missing from our economics. And I claim that this is not communism, but Christianity. We've created systems like racism, sexism, and oppression in general that we believe exist without racist and sexist, because none of us want to call ourselves such horrible names. But to pull an Alan Harris, one thing we've learned from Avenue Q is, among many other things, everyone's a little bit racist. You, my church, my beloved church, you are the church that welcomed the queer community. You are the first DOC church in Ohio to have an openly gay minister and to become open and affirming. You are the church who welcomed me, a young, loud, biracial woman who suffered from depression because of fear of scarcity due to crippling student loans and underemployment when I walked in your doors. You've embraced me and loved me, and other people who are Afro-descendant, indigenous, differently abled, with various levels of education and wealth. Do you still do this today?
Yeah.
The rich with abundance rely on an ideology of scarcity, and the poor suffering from scarcity rely on an ideology of abundance. And this is not just to be equated to wealth, but also, right, the rich in spirit, the rich in stability, the rich in love. We ask ourselves whether there is enough to go around. And like I said at the beginning, I believe and I hope in that liberation that has been taught to me within these walls. I don't care if you think that there isn't enough. If you claim to be a person of faith, if you claim to be a follower of Jesus, you must listen to what Jesus says. And Jesus clearly says there is enough. There are standards of living in this world that need to be met. Those standards of living include having water, having air, having love, having peace, having shelter, having health care, having education. There is such a thing as too much and too little. And anyone who is rich in the face of poverty definitely has too much. Jesus went around to the people suffering from scarcity, of health, of acceptance, of power, of understanding, and replaced it with the gift of abundance. He endorsed civil disobedience. Imagine if we all followed his lead to work for the beloved community outside of these walls. What would that beloved community look like? It might resemble more of what is inside these brothers in Colombia and elsewhere in the global south? In Colombia, hundreds of thousands of people last year who were farmers took to the streets because economic plans with the United States would mean they would survive on not enough. They would survive on less. And they give me hope because I see them following Jesus' call to action, to real love. And as my Colombian friends, my Colombian brothers and sisters tell me, in moments of crisis and despair, hope is a duty. The women, the children, the steel workers, the auto workers, the farmers, the teachers, they all are telling me that they are in this world, as Jesus calls them, to announce justice, to announce love, to announce liberation, and to denounce the values of empire. We mustn't be naive. We can only have hope if we know and understand the prophet's plan for justice. I ask you today, what is worse? The Colombian guerrillas who are recruiting children, or the government who drops bombs on those children? If fast food workers in New York State are organizing for $15 an hour, do we make comments that they do not deserve that much because people working harder don't make that much? A living wage for a family of four in this county is more than $44,000 a year. Shouldn't we all make a living wage? Shouldn't we all have access to water, to shelter, to love, to healthcare, to education? When we create false dichotomies and pit each other against ourselves, we are only following the values of empire. Isn't that enough for all of us? Do you believe that all lives matter? Why then do we silence and dismiss the need to claim that black lives matter and brown lives matter? In this church, I am so grateful for the ways that we advocate in the community. For HIV rights, for children's rights, for women's rights, for trans rights, for queer rights. But I personally do not see God in me or me in God when we continue to use male pronouns. I was told last week, as I was talking about my Colombian heritage, to honor the tradition of the faith communities that raised me. The Hispanic ones, and the ones, the US ones, in disciples' churches like this. I do honor those traditions, and the language that those traditions bring to the table. But I cannot stand idly by when sometimes those traditions are harmful to our children, to our women, to our trans brothers and sisters, and to our community. Again, I say, I don't care if you think there isn't enough. If you claim to be a person of faith, if you claim to be a follower of Jesus, you must listen to what Jesus says. And Jesus clearly tells us, there is enough. There is enough love to go around. There is enough bread to go around. There are enough fishes to go around. There is enough. Let's review our habits of surplus, debt and assets, consumption, the way that we treat the environment, generosity, solidarity, and rest. I know that you can be the beloved community as you are called to be because I have seen you be, beloved community. I hope and pray this day that we continue to realize that our journey to Columbia this week parallels the journey we take every day in Cleveland. Because Jesus calls us to love and to share and to do justice, which means action, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly, which means simplicity. Help me be the beloved, be a part of the beloved community today. Will you all please join in singing hymn number 655?